Hi, welcome to Almost Cooperstown.
I'm Mark.
And this is Gordon. And we love talking about baseball.
Well, hi. We're back with another episode. And we were thinking, how would you compare the careers of two players who played 50 years apart? You'd have to look at their statistics, but can you really, from an era perspective, compare their impact on the game and say one was better than the other? And with Adam Korengold's help, who helped us with our Negro Leagues look at how they stacked up against major leaguers, we're going to take a look at Cool Papa Bell, who played from the 1920s to the 1940s, and Rickey Henderson, who played from the late 70s into the 2000s. So, Adam, welcome back to the podcast. We're happy to have you.
Thanks. It's great to be back.
So we kind of got into that subject with Cool Papa and Rickey in our first podcast when you came on. And so you dutifully went back and you made another tableau, which we will share with the listening audience. And what did you find when you took a look at this, and help us sort of see what it is, even though we can't look at the graphic at this particular moment?
Sure. Well, so the motivation for doing this was we talked about how now that Major League Baseball's incorporated all of the Negro League statistics, that we can make these kinds of comparisons. And we learned in that first data viz that the Negro Leagues and the white Major Leagues really played at a very similar level, if not an identical level. And if anything, the pitchers in the Negro Leagues had more strikeouts, but their ERA was lower. So there were some kind of stylistic differences, you know, that had to do with kind of what was emphasized with the pitching. Hitting was really equal. And so starting with that premise, your first question was, well, can we compare players in different major leagues in different eras? And, you know, certainly we can debate the finer points of that, because training regimens are different, physical attributes of players are different, the expectations are different. So be that as it may, I like to fall on, when I used to do a lot of reading and writing and read a lot of novels, and back in high school we read E.M. Forster, and he had a book called Aspects of the Novel, where, you know, his thing was, you can compare different authors and you can treat them almost as if they're all sitting around a round dinner table. So you can take authors from, you know, different eras and different genres, and you can imagine them sitting around a table talking. And so the approach here is really similar. It's the idea that you can take two players that were at least apocryphally very similar, both base stealers, both kind of larger than life personalities with a lot of mythology around them, and act as if they were playing on the same field, literally. And, you know, ask, well, what are some common statistics that we might be able to look at and evaluate? And based on that, can we say whether they were, you know, how similar were they to each other? How different were they from each other? And you know, how similar were they? So that was my approach in doing this. Should we get more deeply into it?
Oh, yeah, I'd love to, because I think it's the only way we can kind of go back and talk about these players, because all we have is the numbers. Any kind of pontificating we're doing about how the game has changed in the eras between when Cool Papa Bell played and Rickey Henderson played, that's all subjective and up to personal opinion, because if you're going to say, oh, well, guys used to run less back in Cool Papa Bell's days compared to when Rickey Henderson did it, well, the numbers will bear that out when we look at them, rather than us kind of just going off of a feel thing, especially when you're talking about a guy like Rickey Henderson, who basically wrote the book on base stealing. So it's going to be a little bit hard to just compare eras in that respect, because you're comparing an outlier in literally every era when you look at him.
Yeah. And that's one of the things that we see, actually, when we delve into the data. So if we just start with straight steals, and so when you go onto the actual Tableau dashboard, you'll see two dashboards in what's called a storybook. And so in that first dashboard, there's a graphic at the bottom with head-to-head stolen bases by their career year. So Cool Papa Bell played for 21 seasons. Rickey Henderson, believe it or not, played for 25 seasons, which is
Adam, keep in mind that we noticed this about Cool Papa Bell. One of the reasons why he didn't play 25 seasons was he did not play any recorded seasons from 1938 through 1941. So four years, he did not stat. So he would have played 25 seasons had he just played those seasons. And then he came back and oddly enough was really good in the last 5 years. He led the league in steals at age 42. So he's a pretty extraordinary player.
And that's incredible, actually. And when you look at their head-to-head stolen bases year to year, of course, Rickey Henderson had more. He played more official games. Bear in mind, these are all quote-unquote official statistics, so we're not accounting for barnstorming. We're not accounting for exhibitions, which the Negro Leagues played a lot of, and probably in a perfect world or in a better world would have been counted. But the profile of their careers are actually really similar, that they both peaked kind of early. But to your point, especially about Cool Papa Bell, they were stealing bases until their last year, literally. So Rickey Henderson, we probably don't even know how old he was in his 25th year, definitely in his late 40s, had three stolen bases.
Right.
2003 or 2004, he had eight the year before. So he wasn't leading the league in stolen bases, but he certainly got more than you or I would have had. And in his 20th year, he had 66, is this right? He had 66 stolen bases.
Mm-hmm. Yes, no, that's the wild thing. He was age 39 and 98, and he had 66 steals.
Can you imagine that? Yeah.
A near 40-year-old man had more steals than Pete Alonso will ever have as an entire career.
Right. Yeah. So, you know, I think that longevity is one expression of how similar the two of them were. And the profile of their careers was relatively similar. So then if we do more of a head-to-head comparison, so I looked at career stolen bases, comparing them to, I think, the top 200 or so stolen base leaders during the years that they played. So 1922 through 1946, not including those 3 years that you guys mentioned for Cool Papa Bell, and then for Rickey Henderson, 1979 through 2003. And what's so interesting about this is I looked at on-base percentage, and just to back up a second, my thinking here was, what do you really want to measure for a base stealer, for a leadoff hitter and a base stealer? So what matters is that they get on base and that they steal bases, because that's what you want them to do. You want them to get into scoring position. And that's basically what base stealing is, right? So on-base percentage is a percentage measure of how likely a hitter is to get on base. Well, Cool Papa Bell had a career on-base percentage of 0.395. Rickey had a career OBP of 0.401. And so when I plotted that out among all the other, again, it's the top 200 or so or 250 base stealers during that period, they're not top necessarily. They don't have the highest OBP, but they're definitely in the top quartile, definitely in the top 50%. So they're doing pretty well there. But when I normalize the number of steals, so what this means is I'm looking at, and forgive me if I'm getting too heavily into the stats here, but
you haven't lost me yet.
Okay. So I'm normalizing for the fact that there were generally more steals in the major leagues, you know, 1979 to 2003 than there were in the Negro Leagues.
We understand that, yeah.
Yeah, and the numbers bear that out, because we're looking at a guy like Cool Papa Bell, and you're telling me he really led the league with 19 steals in 97 games one season? That doesn't make sense. Yeah,
exactly. And so we're looking at their career years, but if I normalize the number of steals, which basically means that I take the average for everyone, and then I take the standard deviation, and I count the number of standard deviations above the mean, mm-hmm. which every player is. So Cool Papa was a normalized stolen base of 8.3. And Rickey was normalized at about 8.1.
Wow.
So that means that they were 8 standard deviations above the mean number of stolen bases, which means they were light years ahead of everybody else.
Even though the gross numbers for Cool Papa, well, you know, he doesn't have a 130 steal season. That's not going to happen in the way that it does. But compared to the other people, which to me tells me that people were not stealing bases very much in those leagues that Cool Papa Bell played at all, because you know his numbers, you know, had to be. It's like Gretzky's scoring 92 goals, you know, versus. Mm-hmm.
They're so far above you guys like Henderson and Cool Papa Bell were so far above their peers and their ability to steal bases that it's like you're almost like I'm doing a disservice to them.
Right.
By you almost need to bring in another top base stealer from that era to be just like, no, understand how much better these two guys were than everybody else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's what we're really starting to see here. And then when we look at single seasons. So here we're doing the same thing. We're looking by single season for Cool Papa and everyone else, and then for Rickey Henderson and everyone else. But instead of normalizing the number of stolen bases, we're just plotting them. So the most steals that Cool Papa ever had was 49. And let's see. I have to see what year that is. I'm not sure what year that was. Rickey had 130. So, you know, you can see you can see the difference in terms of the leagues there. But when you look at their averages compared to the rest of the league, so every one of Cool Papa's, about all but 6 of his years, he was above average for stolen bases. And for Rickey, for all but 4 of his seasons, he was above average, at least above average. He wasn't necessarily the leader, or no, he was the leader, actually. But he was above average for that whole 25-year period.
Which is wild. He played for 25 seasons. For him to be above average in all but 4 of them is like, when you actually think about that, it's wild.
Yeah. Well, and when I say above average, I mean above average for across all of those 20 years for the highest number of bases stolen for everyone, which is extraordinary.
Yes. Well, you look. That's the greatest base stealer in history. You would expect that to be something that might happen.
Yeah. So these guys were good is what I mean to say by that.
And, you know, because you look at things, you know, we like to use wins above replacement. And because this, as we said, the statistics aren't there because they're not counted. And we know that Cool Papa Bell, who seemed to play 97 games in a lot of those Negro National League seasons in the 20s. So that must have been the amount of games because he played it 3 different times. So I'm not sure why 97 was a number of games that they might have played. It seems kind of random when you think about it. But, you know, his statistics, you know, bear out in terms of scoring 90 runs in 97 games. All of a sudden, you start looking at that, and he's scoring 150 runs in 162 games. If you begin to extrapolate even individual seasons, you can start to see the greatness that maybe doesn't come out when you see that the guy had a WAR of 35.3 for his career. And so you kind of dismiss a little bit that kind of stuff because Rickey Henderson's career WAR was 111. Like, oh, wow, well, you know, that makes him 3 times better? No.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. And it when you think about what it means to manufacture runs, it really starts to make a lot of sense. Because if you have someone who gets on base a lot, and then once they've gotten on base, they're stealing. So that means that they're going to get in scoring position. They're at least going to get to second base. And they might get to third. And we don't really have a way of tracking that I know of how often they go, say, from first to third. But if you're fast, you can do that. And that's a way of manufacturing runs. So it makes intuitive sense that someone like that would have a high WAR.
We I did a comparison of the two of them through Stathead. And one of the most interesting stats that came out between the two that sort of let me see something that I hadn't seen otherwise was base running. And there's a category that is run scoring percentage, and that is the percentage of times a base runner eventually scores a run. So Cool Papabo, for his career, the number is 54%. Rickey Henderson for his career is 39%. So, A, that's a giant difference in percent. There's enough of a sample size that that becomes significant. And then I started going, 54% of the time? Is that true? So he got on base and he scored 54% of the time he got on base? That seems ridiculous.
Yeah.
I think the other really interesting thing is we're looking back at the Cool Bop of Bell statistics, and we've looked at everything, and there is a noticeable hole in the gather statistics, because as much as I would want to believe that what I'm about to say is true, I know in my heart of hearts it is not possible that not once in Cool Bop of Bell's career was he caught stealing. We don't have his caught stealing numbers, so as far as we know, he is 100% success rate on his career, I think 285 steals, yeah. So it's just wild to think about. I know he had to be really good, but that was the thing about Rickey Henderson. He stole 130 bases in 82, but he got caught stealing 42 times. That's a lot, actually.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You could add to that he never struck out either, Gordon.
Yeah, he never struck out. I think the other thing, wow. It was when I was looking back at his statistics, the only thing I could think is, it's like the other thing I'm thinking is we only have them playing for 97 games, and we don't have all the exhibition matches they were playing. So all I can think is, what parts of his early career, when he was at his peak, did we miss just because we didn't have the ability to go around collecting some of these statistics that would have shown what he was actually doing? Because it seems weird to me that after 32 and 33, he really barely played. Maybe he was hurt, but it feels like there's all these missing statistics from his career, and I could only imagine what it would look like if we could get an even more accurate picture, and what you've done here is really kind of help us bring to that by normalizing all of the data.
Mm-hmm. No, thank you. And it's something that I'd like to try to do more of, because, you know, we do have these questions of people who were really kind of steeped in history, right? And we don't, pretty much what's widely known about them is the quotability and the stories and the legends. And so this helps put some bones around that. So, you know, you've heard about Cool Papa Bell. You've heard that he was so fast that he could turn off the light and be in bed before the room got dark. And it turns out that that's actually true, as Satchel Paige said, that there was a short in the room that caused a delay of about 3 seconds between turning off the light and hopping in bed. So he could actually do that. But because of the role that the Negro Leagues have had in baseball for too long, often all that we're left with is those legends. And a lot of them are true. They make for wonderful storytelling, but now we have the power to be able to look at them in terms of their statistics and ask, you know, how comparable were they? And we talk in data visualization of analytics so much about apples to apples comparisons. Well, now, you know, we have apples in one barrel and we have apples in another barrel, and we're able to make comparisons like this, which is really exciting.
And look, it all comes down to what we said in the first podcast, right? They wouldn't let these guys play in Major League Baseball, right? So how do we do this? Well, first, we do what we did. You know, we looked at the Negro Leagues. They're just as good as the Major Leagues, right? We kind of determined that. Okay, so now, if you want to say, is Cool Papa Bell as good as Rickey Henderson? Well, in their individual eras, based upon what we see, there's a strong argument to be made, you know, that, yes, those guys actually dominated their leagues in much the same way. You want to talk about it, one being longer than the other. And it's just a shame that Cool Papa didn't get the statistical recognition that he would have gotten had he had played in the majors.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Well, I think we should come up with some other comparisons, and maybe some of the folks that listen to our podcast can think about how we can take two players. I think you could do this with power hitters from other eras and just compare your, you know, you can go Babe Ruth and Barry Bonds and see if that works, and compare to the eras and come up with a different viewpoint. Yeah, we know how many they had and that was, but compared to everybody else, you know, Ruth was so far above, and I think he's going to come out looking better in some ways than Barry Bonds did, simply because of the amount at which he was higher than everybody else that played at the time. Barry Bonds, you know, broke the records, but it wasn't like he was hitting, you know, more home runs than some teams.
Right.
Yeah, that's a big difference. It's like, it's the same way when you look at Henderson and Cool Papa Bell, they were stealing bases like nobody else did. So it's like, it's just such a crazy thing to think about it. And but what's interesting is, it doesn't really feel like that's changed. If you had a guy show up and start stealing bases at the rate Rickey Henderson was doing it right now, he would still be a standout to this day compared to all his peers. Whereas with home runs, I don't think you would get as much difference from at least from like Barry Bonds' era, or even the big home run hitters of like Hank Aaron to today.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. And I don't, I think from a numbers perspective, because techniques got better. And when I was a kid, Maury Wills was near the end of his career, but he had the season record for steals in a season that was broke by Lou Brock. And then Rickey Henderson shattered that with 130, and another guy, Vince Coleman, stole, I think, 110 for the Cardinals one year. And that's, I think, the all-time National League record. But it was kind of like a bubble, right? These guys kind of rose up, and for a while, you had guys stealing lots of bases. And then nobody came close to stealing 100 bases in a season. You know, if a guy got 70 steals, that was a big, you know, deal. And today, it's not the way. So it was sort of this sort of rise of time. And Gordon, I think you're right. I think if somebody went out there and really, you know, outperformed and could just steal more bases, I guess the techniques to catch these guys have gotten better. Catchers got better. We talk about pop times now and things of nature that never, nobody's talking about pop times when, you know, Lou Brock was playing baseball, that's for sure. So you know, it would be interesting to see, but yeah, let's have you back, Adam, and we'll come up with another interesting subject.
That sounds great.
And thanks again.
I'd love that. Well, thanks for having me.
Thanks for listening. Subscribe to our podcast on your favorite platform.
And you can follow us on Twitter @AlmostCooper.